next panel discussion, which will talk about building a strong, desirable brand through content marketing. And we have with us stellar panel that we have here. I would like to introduce to all of you, and please go ahead and drop in your questions or just tweet to us your questions, and we would definitely ask our panel to discuss it further during their conversation or after. So let me first invite, ladies and gentlemen, Prachi Mohapatra, CMO, FBB Future Group. A very warm welcome to you. Also inviting Bhagyashree Navari, Associate Director and Category Head, Kurkure and Cheetos at PepsiCo India. Nishant Kashikar, Country Manager, India and Gulf Tourism Australia. Amarpreet Singh, EVP and Portfolio Head, Diageo India and Board of Director, Royal Challengers Bangalore. On our panel, we also have Krishna Rao Buddha, Senior Category Head, Parley Products. And to chair this session, I have with us from Exchange for Media, Nazia Alvi Rahman. She's the editor at Exchange for Media. So I'd welcome all of you here. I hope all of you had a good day today. Before we begin, some smiles would be great. And Nazia, if you'd like to unmute yourself and take over the conversation. Thank you, Nishan. Very warm welcome to all of you.
Thank you, everyone. Good to see you all.
Hi, everyone. You can hear me?
Yes, Nazia. Loud and clear.
Thanks. So if Bhagyashree and Amar or Nishant also can do their mic test. Prachi is on mute.
Can you hear me, Nazia and everyone? Prachi, yeah. Bhagyashree, Amarpreet. Hi.
Yes. Hi, Nishant. Hi. Am I audible?
Yeah. Audible. We all are audible.
Krishna? Are we waiting for Krishna to join us?
Yeah.
Hi, Nazia, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, Prachi.
Yes, Prachi, can hear you. Hi, Bhagyashree, I think you're frozen.
So while Krishna joins us, I hope there is no technical glitch at his end. Okay, Krishna is joining.
We've lost someone.
Okay.
You lost Bhagyashree.
Okay. So we'll wait for Krishna and Bhagyashree. You know, despite all these glitches, virtual conferences are pretty much on time. I mean, if we would have done it the way we have been doing in past many years, it would have been impossible to start by 4:15.
That's the advantage of going virtual, right? I mean, all meetings start on time. Not sure whether they end on time, though.
So that is one big disadvantage. But we'll try to close it on time. We'll try to keep our debate to the point and as pointed and as insightful as we can. So,
again, we've lost someone.
Yeah,
I think Prachi.
Prachi is.
We'll wait for a minute, I think, or two. Otherwise, I'll start with you all, and then they can join in later.
Sounds like a plan.
Sure. Khaiti has already introduced all of you, so I don't have to do that. And even she has mentioned the topic, which is how content marketing can help build brand identity. So maybe we can just hi Krishna. So now we have everyone, right?
Yes.
So let's start the debate. I mean, I'll try and speak as less as possible and ensure that you all speak more than me because you're experts on the topic. And the value that you guys can add to the debate is has to be far more than, you know, that is how I believe. I mean, I don't know if it is true for most journalists these days, but I think panelists should talk more than the journalists. So let's start. And the first question that, you know, we want to speak about and we want the debate to, you know, focus on is that this has been a very, very unique year. It's kind of year where the entire globe has suffered a pandemic and, you know, everyone has lost a lot of, I mean, if not close ones, you know, people that we know via somebody. this is a very it's a year that has brought in a lot of stress, and for marketers it's been a very challenging year, because you know, in these times you just don't know how to sell. You know, when people are going through personal tragedy, people are worried about their lives, your focus is entirely different, people are worried about their jobs. So this has just made the role of content marketing even more important and, you know, more pivotal for all of you. That is the question I want to start with, and maybe Krishna can start first and then we can move on.
Nazia, I'm very sorry. Would you please repeat quickly?
So Krishna, I was talking about 2020, that this is a year of, a lot of losses, in terms of revenue, in terms of business, in terms of lives. It's not a very easy year for marketers, you know, to sell their products, because people are experiencing all kind of losses. So do you think this kind of pandemic has made content marketing even more important?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So if you look at the way things sort of panned out right from the end of third week of March, so absolutely marketers were sort of stuck with the challenges of first and foremost catering to their business demands. So communication would come a little later, but primarily with lots of confusion, lot of ambiguity in the system, what is essential and what is not with the lockdown. The most important aspect to look upon was how do I get my business mobilized. And it took us about a week, 10 days for us to sort of mobilize, and by the second week of April we were sort of on a roll. Okay, and till such time we had plenty of inventory which sort of managed and helped us cater to the business requirements. Yet there was crazy public hoarding, and there was huge demand in the market, and the shelves were all getting empty real fast, despite the fact that the retail shops, the mom and pop shops or the modern retail shops were open only for select hours, as short as maybe a couple of hours or so. Lot of modern retail was also shut during that time. So once we sort of took control of those things is when we sort of thought of what do we do in terms of maintaining a good connect with our consumer. And that's when we started seeing, because shooting was not allowed, so creating a new content was on that, you know, the traditional way was absolutely a non-option. And that's when we realized that there was a lot more opportunity to create content just by shooting right from the confines of your respective homes and coming up with interesting ideas, and that's how sort of brands mobilized. We did a lot of it actually. For every small event, possibly in a regular scenario, we would not have really bothered to do as much. But during the lockdown, so it actually triggered us to sort of think and create a lot more content. So I agree with you. It definitely mobilized lot many marketers to create new content pieces to have a better connect with their respective audiences.
So if you can give us an example of, you know, what was one of that important piece that you created during this lockdown?
All right. So first and foremost, started with, okay, let us, can we actually, when we spoke to our creative partners, we asked them, can we look at actually creating a new content? And they said, out of question. So when we sort of brainstormed, we said, okay, can we look at our own footage from various creatives, commercials that we had done all this while? So actually the agency put in together all this previous ads that we had shot in, largely shots which were indoors. So they actually happened to stitch all this content together to come up with a thought of, like, you know, stay home, stay safe, and this is the time. This is actually, people were starved and people were sort of deprived of spending time with their near and dear ones. So now when we think back about the past 8-9 months, we feel this is normal. But earlier, all of us hardly found time to spend with our near and dear ones, with our family members. So this was a wonderful time. So people, and this was also a vacation time, almost the exams had gotten over. So this was a wonderful time for all of us to spend time to bond together. I think so we came up with that communication. That was one. Thereafter, we came up with a new piece of content, exclusively shot, of course. This was on proper cameras, etc., but with very, very limited resources. So this we did during Eid. So Eid, usually we would not have done much. But then here we felt, okay, can we look at doing something for Eid as well? And we came up with yet another piece of communication, which was, of course, promoted across social media and various digital platforms. So those were a couple of examples.
Prachi, if I can have you in the debate now, Krishna's is a industry where, you know, even if he wouldn't have created all those campaigns, you know, people would have still gone out and bought his products because of the nature of the industry. But FBB, I don't know. I mean, I'm not sure how many people during the peak of the lockdown were interested in, you know, spending on clothing. And how did you reach out to your consumers, and what kind of content marketing tools did you use before festive season? I mean, once festive season started, then we can understand. And even festive season this time, the kind of content we saw on television was far more different from what we've been seeing every year. Prachi, you're on mute.
Can you hear me? Am I audible? Yeah, I can hear you loud and clear. Can you hear me now? Yeah, yeah, okay. So I think from what Krishna had shared, and Krishna and I had been in such a panel earlier also, wherein we had shared our emotions already very early part of lockdown, wherein we have shared these emotions that how it was so difficult for consumers to even get anything as basic as food. I mean, it's non-essential. Like, fashion was very way down in the list at that point of time. But something as basic as food was so difficult to get to. So for us, from that perspective, we had been very clear. From a content perspective, we were saying things that how is it A, we are open, B, we are stopped, and C, you can reach us via anything, any medium that you want to. You want to WhatsApp us, call us, shop online, or during designated time period walk into our store. So whatever it may be, we're just there for you. See, very, very very basic thing, I think all of us would relate to. Before marketers, all of us are consumer customers, so we definitely would like to be treated by brand the way we would like to be treated by a brand. The brand would like, should be treating any other consumer that it's reaching out to. So we were very clear in our head what is that. Over and above, as and when non-essentials opened up, as and when fashion started opening up, and you know, there were practical problems like bachche bade ho gaye hain, kids, definitely you have a kid, Nazia, you know, kapde ab fit nahi aa rahe hain. 3 months pehle, when we entered into lockdown, jo bachche ka size tha, it's not fitting anymore. We are all in Zoom calls. We're always inside home. So the product mix has completely changed.
Not the kids, even all of us, you know.
Because everybody, whatever respectable top wear we are wearing.
Prachi, I mean, I don't know if I'm the only one who's experiencing it, but your voice is cracking a lot.
Yeah, there's a bit of distortion.
There's a lot of disturbance. If you can just check your internet connection, because, you know, there's hardly any sentence that...
I'm sitting on the router now.
So maybe I can have Bhagyashree in, and, you know, you can just check your internet. You can try
doing
something else.
Yes.
Yeah, there's a lot of disturbance. Bhagyashree, if you can join in and, you know, give us your perspective on how did you handle the situation and how did you use content marketing during the pandemic?
Yeah, actually, you know, I completely echo with what you know, my co-panelist said earlier, and it is very important at such a time to be relevant to consumer needs. And I think most of us, you know, who are managing brands would have noticed that the consumer expectations from brands is moved drastically. And I'm just recalling a Edelman report, which you know, told us that globally and also in India, 85% of, you know, people want brands to, as they call it, solve my problems. And 80% want people to solve society's problems. So, and also, you know, trust as a feature or a driver to drive the brand has gone much higher. And it's second only to price. And so it tells us that, you know, what considerations consumers are having while making purchase decisions. And therefore, this reflects in that building and maintaining brand trust is, you know, very essential at this point of time. And it goes from beyond the need for us to build brands for commercial purposes to build brands that, you know, actually speak to society and their needs. So when we were doing this with our consumers, you know, we realized that it is important to speak in a way that truly establish a deeper connect with consumers. And it's, you know, it's also true to our core. So, for example, on our brand Lays, the core purpose of our brand is to bring moments of joy to people's lives, right? And this time we said, you know, how can we bring joy to the unsung heroes who work hard to bring us what we love while, you know, we stay in the confines of our homes? And therefore, the campaign that we launched, you know, on Lays was, you know, the Heart Work campaign, as we call it. So, you know, kadi dhoop mein jab koi mehnat karke aata hai, to wo heart work kehlata hai. That, you know, that's what we kind of put out to consumers. And that was the first step. So we said, how do we thank the farmers, the truck drivers, the retailers who get us what we need, but they're never really seen, anywhere out. So that's the first step we did. And that, you know, that campaign, of course, we took, you know, all over. We said one step further is we joined with the Smile Foundation, and we said, you know, can we work with the Smile Foundation and bring hygiene kits to these farmers, to the truckers, you know, to the people who work through our supply chain, to our plant workers, etc. And that got attention of people. So when we went to influencers, you know, in on social, and we said that we want to put out this content, you'll be surprised, but you know, people wanted to use their voice and put out this message out to say, you know, this is an ode to people who are doing this for us, you know, through their hard work. And then they themselves put out a plug to say, you know, this is the Smile Foundation link. If you want, you know, you can come and donate here. And that really got a lot of people by themselves come out and you know, share on the link. And thereafter, we said, you know, let's go one step further and, you know, let's broad base it. And it should not be, you know, just a lay story. And that would be the, you know, that would be the pettiest thing to do. So we said, so we went out to about 30, 40 brands. We went out to actually 40 brands across, you know, the industry. And we acknowledged them and thanked them for what they're doing for their own employees, for consumers, for supply chain, for their supply chain teams. And that was the campaign actually that did very well on Twitter too. So consumers do take note of how you're speaking beyond what you're... and then, of course, we went to building another leg to it. And we went to meet students and bigger artists and smaller artists and launched a campaign called Artwork for Heartwork. And I call it a campaign, but it's really, you know, part of the bigger purpose of building, bringing heart work and acknowledgement. So we tied up with leading artists and, you know, students who expressed their thanks through artworks. And we brought this together through a first ever a platform called artandfound.co.in. There is a platform already on this. And we held the first ever, you know, exhibition on this where artworks of these people, whether it was big artists, you know, or leading names like a Sonu Sood or Manushi Chiller, their artworks also fetched money, but also regular people like me, you know, would buy from there and be donating. And we raised about, you know, 6.5 lakhs from there. And people also donated to the Smile Foundation. So what I'm just saying is it is important for the brand to be speaking to consumers in a way that is purposeful and meaningful to their lives. And that is the core of building empathy, trust, and a deeper bond at this point of time with consumers. and that's how we did.
As human as possible. In fact, we I have a question on that, but most of you are already answering that. So, I mean, fair enough. And you're also telling us all the good work that you have done, but I'll also want to know from you later in this debate the good work that others have done, so that it doesn't really look like a sales pitch in a way, only talk about your health. Now if I can have Amarpreet in the debate, you know, Amarpreet, you tell us that how have you handled your brand and how have you used content marketing in this pandemic year?
Yeah, thanks, Nazia. And some really very relevant points raised by Krishna, Prachi, and Bhagya. I mean, yes, when the crisis started, we all know what happened to our category. I work in Alcobev.
We're
all connected to the category as consumers. There was actually a month where we sold zero sales for the first time ever in April. Everything was closed. But yeah, and if you would ask me at that point of time, what was the most important content strategy I had in mind? It was whiskey, soda, and ice. Well, those were the only three content I was interested in. But yeah, you know, keeping on the lighter side away from this conversation, I think, look, you know, some of the rules of the game haven't changed. Yeah, and that's my personal reflection. As I think Prachi mentioned about, you know, treating consumers as humans, right? It is, you know, we sometimes treat our jobs as marketers a little bit too seriously than what we should, right? I mean, you know, if you just put yourself in their
shoes. I'm interrupting. You know, I see, I understand Prachi and Krishna and Bhagyashree's categories. They're very easy to advertise. Yours and Nishant, the sectors that you're handling, they were not that easy in this. Because you can't advertise too much. And Nishant, because the sector is not, he doesn't have anything to sell right now. Yeah. So that is the context in which I want to understand how you have used content marketing.
Sure. So I think the first big shift which was happening was for us was about access, right? Once access was sorted out in terms of retail opening and business starting, I think the big thing about content for us was really about understanding the changing consumer behaviors, right? And there were two or three powerful things which were happening. One is that consumers are becoming very value conscious. You know, I market primarily the Indian whiskey portfolio. Yeah. And therefore, you know, with the kind of mass migration which was happening, you know, not enough money in everybody's pocket, the overall value consciousness was becoming very, very important for consumers.
The very senior CEO, he told me that, you know, it doesn't really make any difference to me, but still I've cut down on my alcohol psychologically to save money, you know, because We are all going to pay cuts, you know.
Yes.
This was sometime into the lockdown.
Yeah. And you're right, Nazia. And we did see that as many categories saw, we did see a tightening in terms of our growth in the category, which is quite evident in the kind of performance which has been put out in public. So we saw that tightening in terms of the consumer purse, and therefore, you know, this is not fundamentally a necessity category. You're semi-essential, so to speak, and therefore there was a tightening there. We also see a lot of shift in consumer behavior in terms of where the consumer is drinking. A lot of our category consumption happens in on-premise. And with on-premise being closed, a lot of the consumption was moving into home. But as we know, in a country like India, you know, not everybody stocks at home, consumes at home. So that created an interesting consumer dynamic. The other big thing which was happening is in terms of the content, in the way consumers were, you know, absorbing content. The amount of time people were spending on OTT and, you know, all these digital platforms just, you know, kind of catapulted during this particular frame because people had more time. And that was another thing which we captured in. So I think all our ideas, and I'll talk about a couple of them, but really what we saw is that because there was not enough money from an advertising and promotion perspective, because the priority was about access, get the business started, it led to two things in our category. One, I mean, exploration of new ideas. And, you know, in our category, we really do big, large-scale campaigns. And you have seen that on our brand extensions. But we were now doing campaigns with very little money, right? And that really pushed creativity, really pushed creativity. And the level of collaboration which we saw amongst agency partners and internal teams was at quite a peak for Selenium this time. A couple of things which we did interestingly in building on what Bhagyashree was saying. Similarly, for example, we have a brand, McDowell's Number One, which is really and it's a big brand, and it gets consumed with friends, right? Primary consumer is the friends sitting together in a casual get-together occasion. And our brand extension is soda, and through which we basically do that advertising. And on Friendship Day, when Friendship Day was coming, I mean, typically what you do is you go out and meet friends, right? But how would you do that during the pandemic? And we are in simple insight of actually using our past assets, you know, remodeling them and actually running a program where people could send virtual hugs to their friends, right? And that got us a lot of visibility per se. Similarly, on another brand called Royal Challenge, and because I also am on the Royal Challenges Bangalore board, we had the flexibility to use some of the assets which we have on Royal Challenge RCB cricket team. And we were able to take some of the COVID hero stories, right, out there. And you might have seen the kind of stuff where the RCB players were wearing jersey with COVID heroes per se across the IPL. It was actually the first for BCCI to give a permission like this. And a very attractive social media campaign where Virat and all the RCB players for a day change the social handle names to the name of the COVID heroes. And what we're going to do is that those jerseys from the first match are going to be auctioned, and the money which is going to be raised will be given to an NGO. And we put a good amount of media money celebrating those 18 COVID hero stories. So I think what really the sense is that during this period, marketing had to evolve, right? Because the context was different, the consumer mood was different, and we couldn't have kept the AirPods on and continue to work as you were working earlier. So we had to take them off and really listen to them.
So I think we're still on first question and we have exhausted half of our time. So Nishant, if you can also answer this briefly, I also have to go back to Prachi.
Sure. I'm not sure whether you intentionally kept me at the end because the international borders are not yet open. And therefore, it's going to take some time for travel to come in.
Because I knew your answer will be different from others.
Yeah. So I guess when we started 2020, you know, we were all gung-ho about this year to, you know, which we felt would belong to Australia, you know, because we had 6 years of consecutive double-digit growth in arrivals and spend. We were growing at a rate which was double the, you know, outbound travel market. We had earned the distinction of being the fastest growing inbound market for Tourism Australia for 3 consecutive years. And then we had 2 World Cups taking place. We had the Women's World Cup that took place in February and March, and then the Men's World Cup, the T20 World Cup was slated in October and November. So we were quite excited with the whole opportunity that was, you know, in front of us. But having said that, we know everything that has happened. And what we've been trying to do over the past 8 months, and we've been having 8 months of literally no sales. You know, you guys have been lucky to get back to business in 8 days or 8 weeks, but it's been 8 months for us where people have traveled only on compassionate and compelling reasons. So all we've done during this particular phase is stay in touch with our high-value travelers, people who believe, who we believe have the propensity to travel despite what everyone's going through, and keeping the lights on, keeping the content slightly more fun and entertaining, and inspiring people by giving them reasons to travel to Australia as soon as the borders open. So everything that we're doing in this period is creating that aspiration to travel to Australia as soon as the borders open. So we've been feeding them with content like 360-degree videos where sitting on the couch, sitting at home, you can actually transport yourself to Australia and visit some fabulous locations. We have been having this live from Australia sessions where, you know, experts from the Great Barrier Reef, from, you know, some of the nature and wildlife parks, from the MCG, from the Opera House and various multiple attractions that Australia has to offer came live and interacted with our travelers and customers. We recently launched a series of 8D you know, audio videos. This is kind of a sound engineering technology which takes you to Australia. You hear the sounds and sounds and sights of Australia and across different wonderful places that that the destination has to offer. So we are actually making the content slightly more entertaining. We are giving people reasons to travel as soon as the borders open. And now I know we have the Indian cricket team in Australia. So we've got a fantastic contextual media and PR opportunity. So we're going to leverage this across multiple platforms. We're working with all the OTT platforms like the ESPN Cricket Info. We're working with Sony LIV to create some content behind the scenes. Luckily, the stadiums will be not full with spectators, but Australia would be allowing between 25% to 75% of the of the total capacity that the stadiums have to offer, and that's going to give some positive message to Indians that Australia is relatively safer and has been able to manage the pandemic really well. So we're going to work with the OTT platform. We're working with a lot of content platforms as well to create some nice, fun, interesting content. We're working with a lot of Instagrammers. We're collaborating with both Australian and Indian cricketers to showcase the Australian way of life, taking them to various locations, provided they're allowed to travel outside the bio bubble. So a lot of content been created in that inspirational and aspirational phase so that as soon as the borders open, people can think about Australia. And as a result of the numerous activities that we've done, we've still seen that the intention to visit Australia, the consideration, the desirability to visit Australia is still quite high as compared to some of our key competitors. What we've also done during this phase is held hands of our key partners really closely. We have a program called the Aussie Specialist Agents. So we have trained almost over 15,000 agents, giving them knowledge, giving them imparting more destination information so that they can launch new products, experiences as soon as the borders open. So we are working closely with some of our key partners as well, trying to work out new partnerships with the likes of some of the banking partners, products like Airbnb, Visa, MasterCard, something that we've never worked in the past, and also engaging with the Australian industry, because the entire industry is going through a tough phase. It's all about keeping that dream and that hope alive, because we believe that India as a market has got tremendous potential. And as soon as the borders open, we'll soon see this phenomenon called revenge travel, and people will travel like never before.
That is true. I mean, we all are waiting to get back to travel. Prachi, you want to complete your point before we move on to the next question?
Yeah, I don't know how much was I audible and how much could I? I'm
could
just gathering from what I.
Yeah.
So the point that I was trying to make here, when there has been no playbook which could have prepared us for this situation, and all of us are actually putting that emotions out. I think in the beginning of 2020, we had our targets fixed, we had our plans fixed, we had our budget fixed, and what the situation has done is, as Amarpreet also mentioned very correctly, whatever digital maturity any organization had been, it has just pushed the organization to go to the next or the next five steps up. There is no option. It's just you're pushed back against a wall and you really need to make your way out on it. So when we went into lockdown, I think a business our size really takes a lot of time to make a change. And any change takes time to percolate. For us to be able to get our online site in 14 days was a major achievement by itself. The only two things that we were trying to achieve by doing this is, the content or the voice that we had on the market was, we are open, we are stopped, and reach out to us any which ways you can. I think that's the only voice that we had. And this is exactly what I was telling, that before marketeers, all of us are as consumers, we were also struggling to get our food rations out at that point of time. So all we cared at that point of time was to make this voice audible. While we were doing this, as you mentioned, yes, fashion definitely was a non-essential. It was closed. By the time we opened in the next 2-3 months, I think a lot had changed. Our product mix went into a complete different kind of avatar. In fact, when we opened up, we were actually having a campaign called New Fashion Essentials. You're not worried about what you're wearing in the as a bottom wear, you're just worried whatever you're wearing as a top wear. So there were products like tees, kurtis, shirts, and sleepwear that definitely has taken another level of product mix. In fact, just to give you an example, it went by 5x in our product mix. So this is something that had happened. This is something that we were prepared for. From an electronics perspective, we were very clear that as soon as it would open up, there will be requirement for laptops, extra laptops. Bachcho ne kabhi online padhai nahi kari thi. So definitely there was a requirement of another laptop. Parents can just loan the kid a laptop for as many hours. You have work to do. So there will be requirement of laptops, there will be requirement of epilators. These were our forecasting changes that we had to just pick up and make a change to it. And as Nishant is still going through the pain pangs of prepping the customers to come back and be prepared, this is what we had prepped up just before opening up in from the various category point of views. And that's how we have managed our content.
So quickly, I'll move on to the next question. I think we'll only be able to, if our answers continue to be of this length, we'll only be able to accommodate one more question, which is that, you know, all of you told me, you know, how you tried to give, you know, all the content was had that human touch, and, you know, trying to talk about connect with the people who were the real heroes and all. But that all sounds so similar, you know, still you have to stand out because you have to be different. So, you know, in this content thing, you know, trying to be human, are you not all being same? You know, how do you be different also is what I want to understand from you. Again, if we can start with Krishna.
Yeah, that's a tough one because, yeah, the thinking process largely would remain the same, and this would be category dependent. So every category, how you are going to adapt, the emotions are going to remain the same, be it India as a country
but
or
a lot of people, the entire globe. There was a COVID fatigue at one point of time that, you know, every brand is only talking this. Any which way, every second person I'm meeting is talking this. I don't want to talk COVID now, you know. Maybe you can reach out to me in a different way, and I also need a break from COVID. So did you guys, I mean consumers, you know, so did you guys also think on those lines, you know, when you were planning your content in the late, I mean, after a few months of the pandemic?
No, so specifically, that was not really. So like I am going back to the same point wherein it's still category dependent, though the underlining thought would remain the same. It's all about the human emotions. But how are you going to connect it with your brand? I think that is what makes your brand stand out. Though while you were talking or you were mentioning about talk about some other brands, frankly speaking, Nazia, actually, I'm at a loss to sort of recall brands which have done extraordinary content. And with a lot of thinking, I could actually gather one brand, which was one of the core or one of the beginner, I would say, that was Reckitt Dettol. So they were the ones who made use of Medium before TikTok got banned. So they made fantastic use of it, and they sort of taught the entire, not just India, the entire world as to how to wash one's hands safely for a full complete 15 seconds. And that had terrific following, actually, and everyone was like taken aback. So I think that is one content which really was extraordinary and remained sticky. Other than that,
timely.
Yeah, so absolutely bang on time. It was quite relevant as such. So I think that is one brand. Other than that, yes, there is definitely a possibility that one may get actually lost in the jungle of thoughts. Where every brand is sort of...
You could also not think of too many examples because every brand
absolutely
is doing exactly
absolutely
the same thing.
Yeah. Each one of us would have seen several such content pieces, but then when you ask someone to recall, it becomes extremely challenging. So during COVID times, I'm not really able to recall any other sort of piece of content other than maybe a Colgate, Sindhutai Sapkal. I think they had done a very good integration for during the Mother's Day. I think that was quite impressive as such. So that's my take. Yeah.
Do you agree that, you know, we all are doing, all of you are doing exactly the same thing? How do you now make your brand stand out?
You know, Nazia, what I feel strongly about is it's one thing to want to stand out, but what the brand wants to do is to connect with consumers in a way that's relevant to them. And it is true to its own purpose also. And in doing that, every brand would, you know, put out something that is true to its purpose and speaks in a way to the consumer that truly matters. And I think there are like stages in that. You know, of course, we saw there's a stage one before COVID where mostly we would put out content and the consumer would like, engage, share, you know, or may not. And then as we come to a stage two where consumers connect with each other through the brand in a way that the brand helps them be a tool to express themselves. Now, I'm going to give you one example from our portfolio, and then I'm going to give you one example of another stage, you know, that goes beyond. For example, for Kurkure, you know, it was important that we speak about how, while we are thanking everybody, you know, who works for us to make our lives comfortable, but are we thanking the people who make it easier for us to bear this difficult time, you know, on an everyday, every moment basis, and which is our families. And they're often actually unacknowledged. We take them for granted, and we, you know, sort of, we sort of actually treat them like ghar ki murgi. But so for us, it was important that we, in our own, you know, Kurkure has a very quirky personality. It's always tongue in cheek. So how can we put out something that helps consumers thank their families in their own way? So we put out a campaign that was, you know, to like an ode to family. Where consumers came, you know, we created a cute jingle where we said that, you know, like, I can't live with you, but I can't live without you. And, you know, when we put that out, and we put it out in a jingle, and we saw consumers come out and do their own renditions of that jingle in their own way, whether some did it through a dance, some did it through pictures, some did it through an act. But, you know, that was one way that the brand, you know, gave a tool for people to express themselves, which was not, you know, in a way that we are just thanking society around. And then there is another level, you know, and I call it the stage, the third stage or a higher stage, where you create a medium for consumers to connect in a way that the community thrives. For example, you know, you can associate with the platform in a way that helps you connect with it and give back to society also. And I think Cadbury's created, and we saw it just before Diwali, they launched a campaign, right? And they said, this is not a Cadbury.
That was a very beautiful campaign. Yeah,
And it must have been taken a lot, let me tell you, from a manufacturer's perspective, you know, in an FMCG company to build a system wherein you can, through a geo-targeted way, be able to get the consumer to be connected to a local store that helps your need for that moment and also helps, you know, the society to thrive in a way. And I think that, I would say, is a very standout idea. Which, if can you imagine that if it goes beyond urban and percolates to rural, then, you know, it really gives a leg up for me as a, you know, local store around who's possibly not getting anybody come to me, is able to get people to be connected. And I think through technology and the brand's purpose of, you know, Cadbury's purpose, they've done that beautifully well.
Absolutely.
I also, you know, recently even Pepsi, our brand, the beverage brand on our portfolio, Pepsi did a campaign called Pepsi Save the Restaurant campaign. And it wasn't about Pepsi there. They said that, you know, we tied up with the National Restaurant Association of India and Swiggy. And they said that this is an initiative to provide, you know, support to the marginalized workers of the restaurant community, where you're not eating.
It was done by McDonald's, KFC, all of them together also. There was another campaign.
I think this is also a way to say that brands are not looking to like do the same thing so much as to come together and be speaking to consumers in a way that the community thrives. So what if they're doing the same thing? So long as we as a society are, you know, becoming, you know, more together, more humane, I think it's a good thing.
So this time I'll take Nishant before I take Amarpreet and Prachi so that he doesn't complain. Nishant, tell me, what is your view about it?
As far as the tourism category is concerned, we are all operating in the sea of sameness. You know, everyone's got beaches, everybody's got mountains, everybody's got wildlife, and, you know, everything that you need on a holiday. So how do you differentiate yourself? And I'm not going to talk about work that we've done during the pandemic, but something that we've done a few years ago.
And like Cadbury did. I mean, that is where, you know, you have to create that thing for yourself. You So that is, these are the kind of things that I'm talking about, like the examples that Bhagyashree did.
So we launched a campaign called Restaurant Australia, and that was to invite the world to experience the Australian culinary culture. And it was inviting people actually to travel on their belly. So there's a campaign which is close to our tummy, actually, you know, something that we've launched. And the and everybody's, you know, heard about MasterChef Australia. Our association with that particular show really helped us to raise Australia's profile as a great culinary destination and the food and wine capital of the world. What the chefs allowed us to do there was to showcase how warm, welcoming, and inviting Australians were. The contestants on the show came from different nationalities, races, and religion. They helped us to showcase how multicultural Australia was. And whenever the show went outside the MasterChef kitchen, outside the studio, you know, we could see the spectacular natural beauty that Australia had to offer. So the MasterChef Australia as a show and association with that particular show really helped us to raise the profile of our destination. We later worked with almost close to 20 food and wine influencers in India, including the likes of Sanjeev Kapoor to Rashmi Uday Singh, Veer Sanghvi, Rocky and Mayur, Vicky Ratnani, Kunal Kapoor, you name it. And every food and wine influencer in India had an opportunity to travel to Australia and experience the culinary lifestyle. And they all created content on their respective social media platforms, various other digital platforms. We also curated content. This was amplified on, you know, YouTube, Facebook, Instagram as well, and thereby raising the appeal of Australia as a great culinary destination. We organized events like inviting the world to dinner and the who's who from the world's food and wine industry to Australia. We organized the world's 50 best restaurant awards, inviting all major influencers who really created good amount of content to raise Australia's attractiveness as a great culinary destination. So this
how
is
about
one of
other
our
other brands. I mean, how about what kind of campaigns that other brands did that you like them and that you would want to speak about
During this particular pandemic?
Yeah.
Where
this concept of content marketing was utilized in your opinion in one of the best ways?
I guess a category that has really thrived during this particular pandemic is the EdTech platform. You know, and you've seen suddenly brands like, you know, Byju's and White Hat Junior, whether it's Upgrad, Unacademy, Topper, really mushrooming. And all of them are now flushed with huge funds because of the VC funding. So we're getting to see some great amount of work, not just on traditional platforms, but also on the content marketing platforms. And something that I wish to highlight is the work done by Byju's. You know, apart from organizing these inter-school quizzes and contests on in partnership with Discovery and Disney, what they've done is they've launched a program called the Byju's Young Genius. So they're trying to identify talents across the country, across different walks of life, like across different streams, be it music, be it art, be it sports, be it coding, be it math, and recognizing such talent. What they're also doing is, in association with the Times of India Group, they've started this learning series called Keep Learning. And that's an education initiative for the parents and the students to understand what are the changes happening as a result of the new education policy. You know, what are the career options? How do you maintain that digital discipline and the time that every kid needs to spend on screen? So it's more of our education initiative that has been undertaken by them. And what they've done really well in terms of a CSR activity is a program called Byju's Give Initiative. And this is all about donating your phones, your laptops, and your desktops to a charity, and they are taking the onus of repairing these things and giving it to the underprivileged so that they can have a better life during this particular period. So I think that is one brand that really stands out in terms of the work that they're doing.
Amarpreet?
Yes. So I think, as I was saying earlier too, I think during this time, we've gone back to the basics, Nazia. I think the three C's which we've always looked at from a content marketing is always about core idea. Knowing what your core brand idea is, what is flexible, what is fixed, you need to be very, very clear about that. And, you know, best content marketing comes when you're very sharp around that. The second is about, you know, being culture in, consumer in, which is what we're all discussing, but not being tone deaf. And I think the reason why you see a certain sense of sameness is that the cultural tsunami of Corona has hit everybody, right? All, you know, that's what's the is the life of the consumer and the culture as they're experiencing it. And the third C for us has always been about commitment, because we believe that content marketing is not a campaign, it's a commitment. You have to do it because for a long period of time, because the more you're consistent with it, the greater the ROIs happen. The more integrated you are, the greater the ROIs happen. Yeah. And therefore, you know, from, I mean, I'll give you two examples, one from our stable and one, you know, outside the category. Within our stable, it's really McDowell's number one, and in the space of friendship and affiliation, our passion space has been about music, right? And therefore, because music, friends, alcohol, they all come together very, very, you know, in a very beautiful way, right? And what we had realized, one of the key insights we realized is that because of the social distance which is happening, you know, we know men are very poor at expressing their feelings. And now if you're not sitting together, drinking together, you're not really opening up and expressing your feelings of what you're facing, how you're experiencing. But actually during this time, people who have really helped us navigate this tough time has been our friends, because they've kept our spirits up. So we have a nice campaign where we're actually encouraging friends to call up their yars and actually say, thank you, yar, for being here around this period of time, right? And we are making some nice, how do we leverage music in terms of making this a little bit easier? Because right now, alcohol is not between them sitting together. So maybe use the power of music to be able to kind of express, right? So that's something which we're doing on our existing brand. If I look at also from a corporate perspective, I think we didn't talk about corporate, but I think a lot of corporates have come forward during this time to actually, you know, show their humane side. For example, Diageo came out with a fund of 75 crores to in a program called Raise the Bar, which is actually about supporting the on-premise, you know, bar setup, because they've lost a lot of business, and how will they really come back when the situation improves? So we have a fund where we go back to those stores, help them put the right sanitation, right kind of capabilities for them to kind of come back and be ready with. And I think something what Bhagyashi was saying about community building, right? So that's a community which we are basically working with. Mm-hmm. Outside of the category, the example which I wanted to say was about Facebook. I think they've some of the recent work which they put out, very interesting. Again, you know, how leveraging the power of the platform, what is the cultural mood in the nation, and being able to use the platform to solve for real needs in culture, I thought was a very smart piece of work which we've done recently.
Prati.
So, so there was one piece of content which has stuck to me right from the beginning of this entire situation when we entered the lockdown, is Unilever standing up with Lifebuoy and saying that, you know, you can use any soap, you can use any sanitizer. It was just such a category speak, and sans any kind of brand push. So, you know, sanitizers were vanishing, soaps were vanishing from the market. And it was not only about pushing your brand, it was about pushing for the larger cause. And it stood out. It has stood its test of time right through the beginning of this entire lockdown situation. That was a huge space, and I think it has struck with me. And to what Bhagyashri also said, I would rather be standing in the crowd sounding humane than sound otherwise. I'm okay sounding humane with everybody else. So this is with us also, as I said, we have just been looking at the consumer as we were looking at ourselves. You know, when we entered the situation, we realized that look at the women of the house. I think her work went by like 5x. I know, I'm sorry to the men in this entire panel, but I know for sure men were pitching, but they were pitching. It was never their job. It was always the women of the house who was actually getting, whether she is working or whether she is a housewife, didn't matter. I think all of us could see it within a month or two that I think our job as the householder care has actually jumped up by many x. And I think from our point of view, we realize this. And since we're in the middle of the entire action with our stores, with our online situation, where we were looking at the entire sale and we were looking at the entire, we were tracking it by the hour, by the minute. So for us, we were reaching out to the women directly. And as Bhagyashri mentioned, I completely corroborate with this, that it doesn't matter whether your content is remembered or not. If it works for the customers, you're reaching out to, bang on. It did its job. And I think it did the job perfectly well for us, to the consumer that we're trying to reach out to the consumer we're trying to speak. This was the part wherein I think we were able to show the humane side. Some of the millimeter change that we definitely keep the engagement on from a beauty and personal care category. So, mujhe yaad hai when non-essentials were not open, our engagement was very dadi maa ke nuske. Whatever you have at home, use it, make use best use of it. And it just is a warming of, you know, conversation with your engaged customers. And as soon as the entire situation eased up a little, we started putting in branded content from that perspective. I think it was just a small changes which helped us as a brand altogether and have a very warm speak throughout this entire situation.
So we have already extended our time, but we still have another 10 minutes. Michelle has been kind to us. She's extended the time by 10 minutes. So, you know, you all have been talking about, you know, how important it is to connect with the consumers and, you know, their needs and human side. But then we all have business compulsions also. End of the day, you know, you all have to talk about those technical terms of ROI and brand recall and all these things that you understand far better than I do. So, you know, if now we can talk about that in terms of, you know, in the context of content marketing. So how much has that, you know, content marketing played a role in, you know, getting you the kind of ROI you were looking at? Okay, let's start with Dishant this time. But you.
All right. Thanks for that, Nazia. You know, not all brands have got the privilege of huge marketing bucks. You know, within the travel, tourism, hospitality, and aviation space, mm-hmm. we see brands having budgets less than 20, 30 crores annually. And this is the entire marketing budget that a brand has, includes your PR agency fees and agency retainer fees and all of that. And therefore, mm-hmm. content marketing plays a very important role, basically to increase their, you know, the share of voice or the awareness for that particular brand, and then, you know, drive that desirability and conversions at the end of the day. So just to give you another example as to how we leverage content marketing to the fullest was during the ICC T20 Women's World Cup, which took place in Feb and March in Australia. And we did that by launching a campaign called Experience the Game and Beyond. It was basically inviting Indians to travel to Australia, and not just for the games, but also travel and see the other side of Australia beyond the stadiums. As a part of that initiative, we launched a campaign called Hashtag Led by Women, Hashtag LBW. And that was primarily aimed at raising the awareness of women's sports in India and globally, and in alignment with the ICC's objective to achieve a world record for attendance and viewership for this particular sport, because women's sport wasn't that big until that point of time. For the first time in the history of any tourism board or any brand, we had the two prime ministers, Prime Minister Modi and Prime Minister Scott Morrison, actually sharing our campaign on their social media platforms. And they reached out to almost like over 55 million, you know, of their fans and followers. We collaborated with the likes of, you know, Mithali Raj. We got all the friends of Australia, all the influencers who had traveled to Australia over the last 10 years under one roof to support this whole cause of raising awareness for women's sports. And later, you know, we carried an 11-member team. We invited an 11-member team of women achievers across different walks of life to travel and attend the finals on the 8th of March, which incidentally was the, you know, International Women's Day. So all these efforts, which costed us less than $500,000, helped us to get an ROI of almost over $12 million. So if you have campaigns that touches your emotional cord, or if you're trying to make a change in the society or cause-led marketing, as we would call it, there are people, there are influencers who would come and, you know, support this whole cause and will help you to deliver much higher returns. And in the bargain, obviously, we also achieved greater visitation from India to Australia. And we also achieved a new milestone of over 400,000 visitor arrivals. So, yes, I do agree that content integration, opportunities are really important towards driving that brand awareness and visibility and delivering a better ROI.
Krishna.
Yeah, so I don't know whether in our case I can say whatever we did has really translated into ROI. Say, for example, so like I mentioned this earlier, as well that every month for us, beginning April, has been an ever highest sales. So May was higher than April and June was higher than May and so on and so forth. So I don't know, irrespective of whether we had done something on Mother's Day for Parle-G or for that matter, any other initiative. Typically, the content that we created was largely a corporate. So wherein we had a mix of all our brands, different brands like across categories, biscuits, confectionery, snacks, bakery, etc. So it's slightly difficult to attribute whether that's really happened or so it's a known fact that all the shelves were empty and absolutely high and dry and there was virtually nothing consumers were looking for any and every packaged food that was available, and we just did the job of filling up the shelves as much as possible, and I think that sort of translated into numbers. So it's very difficult to attribute how much of it actually came out of the content, but it's like it's a continuous process of actually continuously bonding with your consumers. So that's what I can say.
Bhagyashree.
Yeah, you know, for us, we learned early in April that the consumers need actually for there's an experiential consumer need which was really high throughout last year and early this year, and then after the pandemic the consumer said that I'm more value conscious than I ever was, and so it's very important that whatever I'm buying is affordable and really value for money for what I'm buying. And that became a huge need. And so that was one fact coming out of research. And the second one, we learned, all of us know, digital marketing, had a lot going for itself because internet penetration went up, digital adoption went up in a big way, and data consumption went up in a huge way. We launched a campaign. We launched a tie-up with Airtel, in which across our portfolio, across the food snacks portfolio, that's Lay's, Doritos, and Kurkure, we launched a campaign that gave every pack to every consumer free data. So if you bought the 10 rupee pack, you get 1 GB of data free, and you buy the 20 rupee pack, you get 2 GB of data free. And the response is stupendous because data is such a sought after commodity right now, and if you get it on a brand like Airtel, on a brand like Lay's or Doritos or Kurkure, you're really going to grab it out. So that's what we've launched, and not surprisingly, our redemption rates are really high. Actually, the promo is still on, so we'll see it through the year, and we've extended it through the year. But essentially, that's the way to kind of connect with consumers for the value they want and give them something that is really very relevant to them. And that's how we've done it. And we'll see the results of this campaign. We are 2 months down. We'll see it through at the end of the year.
Amarpreet?
Yeah. And Azia, so I think recently there was this article by Liz Burnett in Walk, where he talks about if you want to really predict share of market, actually you should track share of search, and if you're winning share of search, you will win share of market. It's a leading insight per se. And share of search you win by wearing share of heart, essentially, right? And I think content marketing plays a beautiful job there. So I have couple of examples in that space, one for a large brand to answer your ROI question and one for a small brand. I think from a large brand perspective, I believe it's really about commitment. As I said earlier in the three C's, it's about staying the course broadly in that space for a long period of time to be able to move any metrics and deliver any ROI. If you, for a large brand, do a small thing which is fashionable in nature, it won't move anything per se. And we've all learned that the hard way. So we've seen on large brands, year two is much better than year three. Year three is much better than year two. And when you think about content, it's a part of an integrated plan and not just content itself. So that's one of the big learnings for us from a large brand perspective. From a small brand, we can really get lucky. There's an interesting one. I do want to kind of put it out on Captain Morgan Rum, which is a really small brand for us with very minimal money. We've got 100 million reach on our Jiffy channel because the captain was really dancing during the IPL on all the boundaries and the sixes of the wickets. And we never expected that to happen. It was just a silly thing. Somebody, you know, junior in the team thought about it and did it. So, I mean, what's the ROI? ROI is almost infinite because we didn't spend anything on that and we got that kind of media reach. So, I think we can get lucky when sometimes, you know, the context and creativity can deliver that. But if you want to think about a large brands, I think it's really about consistency. And there is a lot of data in terms of how, you know, driving that consistently can help you win share of search and therefore impact brand metrics.
Prachi, you can have the final word.
Yeah, so everything has been said on the ROI part. Of course, all of us are definitely running for an ROI, and you know, more than ever, the budgets are constrained. It's a constraint at this point of time, and definitely have smaller. So, what we have figured out and what we have seen is, you know, throwing content first for reach and then following it up with smaller CPA campaigns or CPC campaigns have really worked beautifully for us. And that's something I'm adding on to whatever my fellow panelists had to say. I'm just adding on to that this is something that has, I think it works for most of us. And with a fantastic call to action, I think the second part of the campaign really gives us fantastic ROI. Every content that is developed has an objective. Either it has a brand objective or a conversion objective. At this point of time, most of us are definitely looking at a conversion part of it. And also keeping the engagement on is the second part of which is going on organically. So there is definitely every voice that you're launching out there in the space has a certain objective, and ROI is a part of either your brand is being, as Amanpreet mentioned, searched more or having a share of voice which is stronger in the market. And conversion is, of course, right there on your face, which you... It looks beautiful to all of us, including the management.
So thank you all. You know, I was reading on content marketing and I came across this interesting quote on content marketing is the reason why search began. So have I been put on mute?
No, we can hear you.
Okay. The noise went away. So I thought maybe we have already exceeded the time and Michelle just gave up on us and has started putting us on mute. Michelle, so we'll quickly wrap this up. It was a very, very interesting session and I wish all of you a much better year and far more ROI going forward. And thank you so much for joining us. You all should keep coming back to E4M as often as you can. Thanks a lot.